Thanks for this session of the State SQL and the 2020 we're going to discuss at this new in Proxy. So quick note about myself, my name is Seneca Ngo. I am the founder of Proxy SQL LLC and the author of the same software of the same name. So my background has been mostly as a MySQL DBA. So we as a company also provide services around Proxy SQL. So if you're interested about Proxy SQL support service, DBA consultancy, development and training, just please feel free to reach out. Also hiring, so quick note here, if you are an experienced coder in C++ and you're interested in MySQL development and everything around MySQL, please feel free to reach out. And of course, we completely remotely. Here, a quick overview of the company using MySQL. Of course, this is not complete, just things here. So our agenda. For agenda, we're going to discuss all the features introduced in 2018 related to Proxy SQL 2.0 and also what is new in Proxy SQL 2.1 that is going to be released very soon. So about 2.0, what the feature introduced in 2020, we're going to discuss about the REST API, we're going to discuss about the firewall, all the new SSL features, improved scalability, a lot of new settings that have been introduced in this major release, and also the support for ARM processor. Instead, what is new in Proxy SQL 2.1? We're going to discuss briefly about performance enhancement. We're going to discuss about all the new cluster capability, extended attributes, the SQLite plugin, very interesting features, other minor features that have been introduced in the same version, and the primitives exporter and enterprise web UI. Those are very big deal related to Proxy SQL 2.1. Now, let's start with the REST API first and foremost. So what is the REST API SQL? So we introduced this ability of create endpoint that a client can reach through an HTTP REST. And on this request, basically the client connects to a specific URI. It can eventually pass certain comment. And Proxy SQL will execute a script that will process the argument. The script will perform some action and then event can return a result to the client. Now, what are those? Well, the script, of course, are something that the user script and that configure Proxy SQL to execute. So there is no built-in script in SQL or built-in functionality adding execute and hitting those endpoint. Instead, the ender can create a script and load them into Proxy SQL and Proxy SQL build exam. Here is an example just to show how it looks like. How to enable it? Of course, you enable through a global variables. The global variables is called admin REST API enabled. By default is false, so you have to explicitly set to true. And the default port is port 6070. Of course, also this can be configured. Now, how does it exactly work? So as if you're with Proxy SQL, you know that almost everything is configured in a table. So there is this table called REST API routes, which the users can configure if the specific endpoint is enabled or disabled. Then it can specify a timeout. So for instance, you can specify that a certain script should not be run for longer than a certain period of time, and it goes beyond the certain period of time, SQL will automatically terminate it. Also, you have to specify the HTTP method. It could be either get or post. Then the UI, the script that is executable that Proxy SQL is call and pass the argument. The client, HTTP client, has passed the argument, and then optional comment, anything. Now, is an example of how to actually configure. So you have to insert into the REST API route. It's the way, the classic way of configuring features in Proxy SQL. And when you configure is active, you configure out of 1,000 seconds. The max case is a post method. The script is computed on export. This is the URI exports. And then the script is in the script directory called export.pr. And then a random comment. Now, the HTTP client has argument in any form, because argument will script. So what format the script is interpret, SQL will just pass those arguments to the. We recommend to use JSON because it's richer as a way of providing multiple arguments. So example, we are calling script, lecture script, specifying a series of arguments, and comment a DB object and min object. So that is nothing more than extracting this script on how to configure, how to connect SQL itself, and the DB object is made of another data. So what the script does in this example, connect to the database specified in the object, and retrieve the users from this, and it configure proxy SQL in those users. We'll have to connect to proxy SQL. Now, if the script returns, I'll set those results to the client. Again, do not enforce any for a result from those script, but I recommend it to be so the client normally is able to in a nice way. Now, the firewall whitelist. Proxy SQL has had always a way of blocking queries using the error message in the MySQL query rules tables. So in the MySQL query rules tables, there is a column called error message. If it is enabled, basically the query will be rejected. So let's just have a quick diagram to show this. The query is coming. Does it hit a query rules with error message? If it's yes, the query is blocked. If it's not, the query is executed. But so proxy SQL, MySQL query rules error message provide a way of blocking queries, but it's basically the way you configure it normally is that you specify all the criteria for blocking queries. Of course, this becomes a bit complicated if you have a lot of rules, a lot of query. You can also convert it into an allow list. So you can specify a lot of queries that are allowed to be executed and at the end of this list, you just have a catch-all rules that says, well, block everything else. And of course, again, this is quite complicated if you have a lot of rules. So we decided to implement this a lot better using whitelist tables. Specifically, we implemented two tables, one called MySQL Firewall Whitelist Users and another called MySQL Firewall Whitelist Users. So again, those are configured using tables. You have username, client, and then in MySQL whitelist users, you have a mode, and this mode could be either off, detecting, or protecting. If the mode is off, basically what happens is that all queries are allowed. If the users is configured in, is configured in detecting mode, basically all the queries are allowed. But if they do not match whitelisted queries, they're basically logged in the error log. And then you have the protecting mode. So in this mode, only the queries that are explicitly whitelisted are being executed. So where does it happen? Where the queries that are allowed are listed? They are listed in a table called MySQL Firewall Whitelist Rules. So let's have a quick look on how things works in practice. So during a normal traffic, what happens is that query hitting the query processor, the processor will perform some action and then it will execute the query. And after it executes the query, it also logs all those statistics about the query, including the digest, in a table called Stat MySQL Query Rules. Now, what it can also perform once we have the firewall implemented, the query processor will query the whitelist user table to know if the users is if the user executing those query, what to do with the query executed by those users. Either allow them, so they're being executed on the backend, or they're just rejected, so the client will receive an error. And so far, we spoke about this implementation. So why the Stat MySQL query tables is important? Because it collects a lot of statistics related to the, so it collects the schema name, the username, the address, and it also the digest of the query. So the digest and so on was executed, etc. So those information are very useful, and those information can become more useful in configuring the other rules related to firewall. The MySQL firewall whitelist rules. So basically this table it has multiple columns, but what are interesting are the username, client address, and the fact it has digest. The digest has to be the same of the digest available in some SQL query digest table. So basically how to combine all this together. So going back to the diagram, when a query is hitting the query processor will determine the mode of the users. It could be either off, detecting or protecting. If it is detecting or protecting, then it will query the whitelist rules table to determine if the query is allowed or not. And how we configure these tables? Well, we can configure this table getting data from Start MySQL Query Digest. So this is actually something very interesting the way we construct it. The way basically that we populate this table is that we let PostgreSQL run for some time. It will collect statistics. It will basically learn about the traffic that is passing through PostgreSQL. And then later on, we can use what PostgreSQL has learned to create rules to allow only the queries that are known and to block everything else. Now, there is a minor limitation here, is that the Start MySQL Query Digest is a table that is just runtime. So if you want PostgreSQL to run for a very extended period of time, probably you will have some mechanism that is at regular interval cleaning this table. So we introduce features allow to store the information from Start MySQL Query Digest into a persistent table on called History MySQL Digest. And this table is absolutely identical to Start MySQL Query Digest, with the exception that it also has a dump time. This dump time is the time when the data was moved from Start MySQL Query Digest to History MySQL Query Digest. Now, how to perform this operation? You can have it either manually or automatic. So you can do it manually or with a script, of course, just executing the command save MySQL query digest to disk, and PostgreSQL will copy the data from Start MySQL query digest to disk. Or you can do it automatically, setting a value to this table called admin Start MySQL query digest to disk. This represents the number of seconds, and every X number of seconds, PostgreSQL will automatically move the data from Start MySQL query digest to history MySQL query digest. And going back to the previous diagram, this is how it will look like. So the statistics about the query are copied from Start MySQL Query Digest to History MySQL Query Digest. And you can use either of those two tables to configure the MySQL firewall whitelist rules. So very simple. How to actually configure them, like what are the query required? Here there are some examples. So if you want to configure the whitelist users, is very simple. You have to execute an insert statement, selecting the user from the MySQL user table, and then also specifying which mode you want, like detecting or protecting. And similarly, to configure the MySQL, the firewall rules, you can just query from stat history, stat MySQL query digest, or from stats, stat MySQL query digest. So you basically have to copy the username, the client address, and the digest, the schema name and digest. Also, we introduce some commands that are specific for the firewall. This has very similar pattern of other module in PostgreSQL. So in PostgreSQL, so you have this command called load MySQL firewall to runtime, save MySQL firewall to disk, load MySQL firewall from disk, and save MySQL firewall from runtime. Also, very important, you need to remember to configure the firewall globally, because all those tables won't take effect unless the firewall is globally enabled. So the configuration will be null if the firewall globally is not enabled. So very important to remember this. Now, other important features introduced in 2.1. Well, specifically in 2.1.11, we introduced two new interesting features. One is that idle is enabled by default, and then MySQL query rules fast routing improve the way it works. Specifically, if we allow to look up that username. So what is the idle thread disenabled by default? PostgreSQL normally has a certain number of worker thread, and those worker thread, they handle all the connection. But there are a lot of applications that create connection, and then those connections are not used for a certain period of time. It could range from few seconds to just a few milliseconds. And those idle connections, they create some load because PostgreSQL has to process them even if they are idle. So with the implementation of these features, PostgreSQL is able to pass those idle connection to an auxiliary thread, and those auxiliary threads are the one responsible for handling those idle connections, while the main worker threads are the ones that are handling the traffic of the most active connection. This allows Proxy SQL to scale to hundreds of thousands of connections without having any CPU performance, any performance hit on CPU. Now, the other interesting features we introduce is an enhancement on the MySQL query rules fast routing. Quick introduction on what it is. SQL allow sharding, performing routing based on username, schema name, and flag in. And of course, if you have only a few shards, that's fine, Proxy SQL handle it very well. But if you have 100, still everything is okay. But if you have thousands or tens of thousands of rules, then performance starts degrading quite quickly. So long time ago, we implemented a new tables called MySQL Query Rules Fast Routing, in which we do not have this performance penalty. It under the hood is implemented as a hash table. So no matter if you have 10 rules or 200,000 rules, the performance is almost identical. The drawback here is that it actually will consume a lot of memory because it has to create those huge maps. Now, in 2011, we introduced the ability of having rules without the username. So if you have a lot of users that they all use the same schema, you can just create one single rules that apply to all users instead of having one rules per schema. This improved memory utilization, but also simplify the configuration, because if you have 100 or 1,000 of users, you don't need to create a rules for each of them, but you just create one applied to them all. So that was an enhancement. Then about SSL, we performed some upgrade of OpenSSL, and also we implemented the loading of intermediary certificate chain. This allows client to connect to Proxy SQL using the verify CI flags. Also, in Proxy SQL 2013, we finally implemented SafePoint. So transactions were always supported in Proxy SQL, but SafePoint were not implemented yet until version 2013. Furthermore, we also introduced a new annotation in queries. So if a client executes a query with the annotation that is create new connection equal one, Proxy SQL will force the creation of a new connection to execute that specific query. In 2013, also had the ability to compile Proxy SQL FreeBSD and also MES. And also we implemented few variables, basically the MySQL connect out client. So it connects to Proxy SQL, but is idle for a certain period of time. SQL will automatically disconnect the client. Previously, this was not happening, so there was a failed action to Proxy SQL and the client were not completing it. Proxy SQL will be forever. Also, we have new variables called MySQL replication lag count, and solves the problem of having replication lag that is spiked. So it might happen that the replication lag spikes for a short period of sometime, even less than a second. The Proxy SQL was doing the check during that specific moment and was detecting a large replication lag, so it was disabling the server. But you know, 1 second after replication, again back to normal. New variables allow Proxy SQL to perform smooth check, disabling a server that is lagging. Or we also added support for 20, and now all the new version of Proxy SQL for Linux release also have ClickHouse support enabled. So we don't have any more two different paths. In 2015, we introduced extra variables called MySQL max transaction idle time. This solves a very interesting problem. Before, we had variables called MySQL max transaction time that was incorrectly named. Basically, this was previously was killing all the transactions that were idle beyond a certain threshold, while in reality, the name suggested this was the total time. So basically fixed this naming unclarity. And we also introduced a new variable called MySQL transaction idle time that performs what the original variables was doing. Also, on the same version, we had Proxy SQL building and running on ARM processor. And furthermore, we are also providing official packages for CentOS since version 7. and for Debian since version 8, so 8.10, and since Ubuntu 18, so 18 and 20. Furthermore, we also have Docker images available. So if you're running, if you want to run ProxySQL on ARM, you can either use our repository or a Docker image. We have those available. Now, new features in ProxySQL 2.1. That's the most interesting on the list. So we upgraded a lot of our dependencies. So ProxySQL relies on third-party libraries, and we upgraded most of them. So specifically, the MySQL C has been upgraded to 3.1.9. We upgraded several of the regular expression library, OpenSSL to the latest, and the SQLite to 3.19.12. Also, we performed a lot of refactoring, and that's allowed us to have simpler code in a lot of portion of ProxySQL modules, and also we found some way of improving performance in certain specific code. Now, we also performed several improvements to ProxySQL cluster, but before spending those improvements, let's just open a small parenthesis describing what is ProxySQL cluster. So ProxySQL cluster is its own native configuration management. So basically, multiple ProxySQL nodes are able to monitor each other and synchronize their configuration if the configuration in one of those nodes has changed. So basically, it implements some sort of replication. Change the configuration of the node, it will replicate it everywhere. Historically, we have the monitoring and synchronization of MySQL users, MySQL servers, MySQL replication host group, MySQL query rules, and ProxySQL node themselves, which are the nodes that are part of the cluster. Now, in 2.1, we perform several enhancements. Specifically, first of all, with the upgrade of the way the proxy gate between them. And in ProxySQL 2.1, communication uses SSL. This means that all traffic between the proxies is encrypted. So this also means that if there are being exchanges between those, they are ended on the wire. Also, when they connect to each other, they also buy each other version. So, and this is part of the handshake, so connect to each other. And if they detect that the proxy has a version different from their own, so if it does not match, they won't be part of the cluster, so they will ignore each other. This sort of issue of having conflicting configuration or conflicting table structure between multiple SQL, so if the version doesn't match, they are not able to monitor each other and they're not able to get the configuration. Also because the configuration is in common between proxy of different version. And the fact that they check the version allow us to synchronize also the variables. So the admin MySQL variables are replicated. This before was not possible because it was a possible to minor release of ProxySQL had different variables. So if the variables were different, they never able to synchronize. So now with this, we're not able to synchronize also those variables. Furthermore, we are synchronizing also the tables that are related to with cluster solution. So especially the tables related to Aurora, the table related to Valera, and the table related to group replication. Great. Now, what else? We also had, we introduced the extending attribute. So let me explain what that means. So every time I want to add a new nums to a table in ProxySQL, this normally means creating a new feature. So for every feature, we create a new column. This creates some problem because it doesn't allow us to create new columns within a minor release upgrade because otherwise the table structure will change. Then have external tool that will stop working. There is increased complexity in the proper cluster itself because now extra columns need to be supported. So the configuration management SQL clusters becomes more complicated. So add the ability of adding one extra columns called attribute, and we configure this in two tables right now, the MySQL user table and the MySQL query rules table. I will show for now the MySQL user. What we are doing is adding this column called attribute. A varchar is an empty string, and here or an empty string. SQLite itself will the input validation. So whatever we're writing there is. So as I said before, either in this thing or a JSON, and every new feature that we want to introduce, either on the MySQL user table, on the MySQL query rules, we can just add these new features as a new object in these JSON attributes. Now, the SQLite plugin. ProxySQL has been using SQLite as its own internal database since ever. It uses SQLite for both in-memory database, so basically the admin when you connect and you configure ProxySQL, but also to persist the configuration on disk and also for statistic purposes, everything is stored into an SQLite database. And the way we do this is because we have SQLite embedded into ProxySQL. Now in 2.1, we have the ability of replacing the embedded SQLite database with a plugin. And this plugin will provide external capability. For example, this plugin, the SQLite plugin, will also support the SQLite encryption extension. And this becomes very interesting because this means that the very first features that will be implemented is the ability of having the database encrypted at rest. So the database file that is on disk, it will be encrypted. So all the credentials that are stored there, and they will be basically encrypted, not just protected at the system level, but also encrypted. Now, we also introduce some more optimization in the way that SAT MySQL just process query, specifically with the different bugs in the way numbers are being handled. So we improve this or we handle this. So this is handled in 2.1. Another important feature with regard to SAT MySQL Query Digest and the web ProxySQL Generate Digest is how we handle a long list of parameters. So it's quite common to have application that issue queries with a variable number of parameters, like 4, 5, 6 parameters and so on. And ProxySQL generate a distinct digest for every number of parameters that are available. And somehow this makes sense because you may want to have a different digest in a query if a query has only one parameter or only two parameters or three. But you know, once you have 10 parameters or 50 or 100, it doesn't make any difference because it just means a long list of parameters. So we introduced these new variables called MySQL query digest grouping limit. And if the list of parameters goes beyond this threshold, that by default is 3, ProxySQL will just list a certain number of parameters and then we'll just replace with a series of dots. So all the queries with a number of parameters beyond this threshold will all generate the same digest. Also, we have multiple ProxySQL command in the admin. We have the ProxySQL stop, start, and pause. Those are related to the MySQL module, so it's able to stop and pause the MySQL module itself. And in total, we have ProxySQL kill and ProxySQL shutdown. ProxySQL shutdown, what it does is that it will shut down a ProxySQL. So it will disable all the module and basically shut down. We realize that the ProxySQL shutdown is not really useful on production environment, but mostly for development. So we decide that ProxySQL shutdown now is being mapped to ProxySQL kill. So ProxySQL just exit as soon as possible. And we added a new command called ProxySQL down slow that will be used for development purpose when we want to perform a full shutdown of ProxySQL. The Prometheus exporter. This is probably the most interesting features that we are going to speak right now. So in a classic, what you have is that you have an application generate metrics and statistics, and then you have a Prometheus export connect to somehow to this application in a variety of way and process metrics from this application and transform those metrics in statistics. And a Prometheus server that basically tape the export, get those metrics and gather them in internal time series. Now, ProxySQL, we decide, this goes to ProxySQL at version 2.1, but in ProxySQL 2.2, we decide to implement these features, and we decide to embed the exporter to ProxySQL. So now, ProxySQL in real time is able to generate those metrics and have them in a formatted ID to be scraped by this exporter. So the primitive exporter all it has to do is to connect SQL and scrape those metrics. getting more into details, as this becomes easier to control because you don't need an external tool anymore, and ProxySQL generate those messages in real time. So all you have to do in reality is to configure the Prometheus server to connect ProxySQL and scrape at certain intervals. This is an example of how ProxAlpha listening on 70 will export those metrics. We are building export, of course, once I have all those metrics copied from into Prometheus and storing it. Now, you will be able to visualize in a Grafana dashboard. We are making the dashboard publicly available. Those dashboard will allow you to see this offer if it is healthy, the status and how many queries are being did. So to have a big information the proxy, but also to go into a lot of details. Here are a few examples of those metrics that are instrumented. Now, the final features that have been introduced in the ProxySQL 2.1 is the Enterprise Web UI. So what is exactly the Enterprise Web UI? So it is basically a graphical user interface that allows to configure ProxySQL to a browser. So it's a web UI. And from here, you will be able to configure ProxySQL, but also to check the status of it, and also view all the monitor information. So as you know, ProxySQL has its own monitoring module, so it check the health of the backend, and all those information are available through the Enterprise Web UI. An important thing to remember is that the Enterprise Web UI is currently implemented as a plugin available only to Enterprise subscribers. So what we have in it? Well, we have a very simple dashboard. The reason why this dashboard is simple is because we don't want to duplicate all the work that we did for the Prometheus exporter in Grafana. So the dashboard here is very simple and shows very few information. But the interesting part is in the configuration of ProxySQL itself. So here, for example, we can see all the users that are currently configured in this ProxySQL instance. And those users, you can delete them, or if you click on one of them, you will be able to update it. So edit this configuration. And also you are able to see the data from either the main schema or the runtime. So which users are actually being used by ProxySQL or what is on disk. So you're able also to see the configuration at the second disk. Also from this dashboard, you will be able to load the users to runtime, save them to disk, and so on. So all the operations that you normally do through the admin interface, now you can do them through this web UI. And this applies to the MySQL users, and just an example, this applies also to the MySQL servers. Again, just click in one of them and you will be able to modify it. Now, further this, of course, you can also create users and create server users shortly after. So very simple here, you have to configure the username, the password, which is the default schemas, and all the settings related to the MySQL user, and then just save it. Similar thing for the MySQL users. So again, you specify the host name, the port, in which host group the server will apply, maximum number of connection, and so on. And of course, this applies also to all the other configuration tables, like in this case, the MySQL replication host group, Galera, group replication, and AWS Aurora. So all the servers, all the cluster configuration, they are all configurable through the web UI. Also, you have very similar things with regards to the MySQL query rules. So again, here from this list, you can delete rules, you can modify them. And if you're familiar with the MySQL query rules, you know that normally you have really a lot of settings here. So we also have to make it more readable, we added the ability of choosing which columns you want to visualize. And this becomes very handy also when you want to create new query rules, because here, for example, when you create a new MySQL query rules, by default, you have the most common columns. But if you want to have other option available, you just have to click on the name of the columns and it will be available for editing. So again, once you create them, you can save the rules from here. And again, you can load them to runtime, save the disk, and so on. Also, from the same web UI, you're able to configure the admin and the MySQL variables. So they are here. Again, from here, you can see what is loaded in the main configuration, what is saved on disk, and what is loading at runtime. And from the same interface, you can load the configuration from main to runtime, or from main, save them to disk. And as well, allow you to configure the firewall, so the MySQL firewall. There are pages that allow you to do this. So both the users and the rules, everything is here. And also from this web UI, you're able to verify also the status of Proxy SQL in all its stats tables. In this example, we are only showing the connection pool. So from here, you can see which servers are online, which one are serving traffic, how many connections are being used, how many connections are being created, and so on. Every tables in the stats schema is available for visualizing in the enterprise web UI. Similar things is for all the monitor table. So they are all visualizable here. And in this example, I'm only showing the MySQL connection pool. And my session is finished. Thanks for joining. And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask on Slack and I will try to reply. Thank you.
Thank you, René, for joining and speaking for Minerva DB Athena 2020. Welcome to the event.
Thank you, Shiv, for having me here.
Thank you. It's always a great pleasure talking to you every time, René. I tell you why. The conversations with you will have a lot of technical insight. You are the product owner, but often you lead the product technology talks towards the compelling needs of a database infrastructure owner or a DBA. That is a creation of Proxy SQL. So let me personally thank you from our committee for submitting this talk about Proxy SQL new features. I tell you, the topics which I want to discuss with you in this virtual fireside chat is like, how do you see like the adoption strategy of Proxy SQL? How early is Proxy SQL beneficial for adoption? Is it like, as we all know that every internet property starts with a single database server until they realize they can't have a single point of failure, then they have a second database server, then goes third, then the number goes high. So do you have one point you say like, hey, this is the right point for you to think about load balancing? So how do you recommend? You've been a DBA, you've been a DBA, so yeah.
So it really depends on when you feel the need of being able to intercept the traffic that is being sent from the application database and be able to perform any sort of transformation. Because if you want to have your transformation that is related to caching and query write, you can start using Proxy SQL from really day one, even if you have just one database server as a backend. Of course, it's never recommended to have just one database server, but you know, it's quite common to have only one database. So if your goal is to be able to introduce features like caching and query write, you can start absolutely from day one. If those are not your top requirement, so the feature that you really need, and instead you want to use Proxy SQL for load balancing the traffic, so to distribute the traffic to multiple readers, or later on if you want to split the traffic between readers and writer, then of course you can implement Proxy SQL later on when you feel the need for those features. But again, those are not the features that most users use. There are some features that other users are more interested on, like for example the ability of multiplexing. And again, most of the users do not think about these features until they hit the problem of MySQL not being able to scale beyond a certain number of connections. And so at this point is when they start looking into Proxy SQL. We have quite common cases in which MySQL is being hit by tens of thousands of connections and then performance start dropping. So there is the perfect time to start investigating using Proxy SQL in this deployment because it can drastically reduce the number of connections. Now, back to your question, when is the best moment to start using Proxy SQL? Is it the beginning or when your infrastructure is way more complicated, more complex? In reality, this is up to you because Proxy SQL has no increased difficulties in being deployed at an early stages or an a later stage. So it really depends when you need the features that it provides.
Yeah, wonderful. Like I tell you, technically the biggest challenge is about choosing the operational the database infrastructure operational tools. I call them as a generic operations tools. The reason because is like when I'm looking forward to scale my database systems like MySQL, definitely I look forward to sharding the MySQL ecosystem in my database infrastructure. Here the challenge is like most often, right? Scaling reads is quite a direct method. Many of our customers, right? I don't know whether you experience that. I mean, like when I talk to many of the customers, hey, can we scale writes? So we strongly discourage scaling writes for several technical reasons. But now when I have a load balancer, right, as Proxy SQL, which is intuitive to route the read write, then if I have an underlying hardware infrastructure, which is capable of providing ultra low latency packet communications, do you recommend multi-database infrastructure writes with the new Proxy SQL, or you say no, or you say like be cautious?
Well, it really depends from the database clustering solution that is behind Proxy SQL. Like if, for instance, if behind Proxy SQL you have some cluster solution that allow multi-write, like Galera or MySQL cluster or group replication, and the writes are successful to be redirected to multiple writer server. Yes, absolutely, that's a good idea. And also furthermore, we also have this ability of routing traffic based on some specific pattern. So it's also possible that to avoid conflict, you can configure Proxy SQL to route the traffic to a specific schema to one server while all the traffic for a different schema or a different server, or you can go even more granular, like all the traffic to a specific set of table to one server, while all the write to another specific set of table goes to yet another server. So it absolutely allows us to shard the writes.
Understood. Now, what do you see is, for me personally, what really appeared great as a Proxy SQL end user, Proxy SQL, you know, like you recommend, I mean, I recommend Proxy SQL for many of our customers when they are, as you rightly said, when they are up to a point that, hey, you know, something we need to seriously worry about scaling the read and writes with a load balancer and don't want application to decide about read write splitting. Now, technically, what I really get excited to work on Proxy SQL. One is like query cache. We all know that MySQL implementation of query cache was not suited for most of the scenarios. It was suitable for some set of scenarios. Great. If you're a CDN, it works great. But then if you have a very dynamic queries and if you're looking at, there are most of the consumer-facing internet properties came out of using MySQL query cache, and thankfully Proxy SQL introduced it. So I'm a big adopter of that. Two is about data privacy, right? If I'm looking at like building a firewall on top of MySQL today, it's less intensive if I have Proxy SQL, right? What do you think as a product owner, you get really excited with a new feature, maybe like one, two new features if you see like, hey, you know something, adopt it, learn about it, it really makes an impact.
Yes. So we have this ability of creating new features on almost any new release. So we started originally as Query Cache and Query Rewrite. Query Rewrite is also a very good way of rewriting query also in terms of privacy. So certain query are never able to get some specific data if they are being queried, or to obfuscate the data using a rewrite. But then later on, we also introduce the ability of blocking queries. And this ability of blocking queries, it evolved over time and now is a full-fledged feature that is the Proxy SQL ability of act as a firewall. So we have these features that basically Proxy SQL can learn all the traffic that is passing through it and querying the database server, and builds its own database of queries that are allowed to be executed. And after the administrator Proxy SQL can basically turn Proxy SQL into a firewall and allow only the queries that Proxy SQL has learned in this process. So every new query that Proxy SQL never saw before, it will be automatically rejected. This is absolutely one of the best features that I like in this actually recent features that is available since the beginning of this year. It's a very, very powerful one in terms of security. Then other interesting features that I am very excited about are the Prometheus exporter. So I was saying before, we always introduce new features, and now we have also this ability of exporting metrics. We always did export metrics, but before those metrics needed to be extracted from the Proxy SQL statistic database and by Prometheus exporter, and then this Prometheus exporter were normally sending data to Prometheus server, so the Prometheus server was getting them. Now instead, we have the ability of instrumenting those metrics, so the Prometheus server can actually automatically get those metrics directly from Proxy SQL. Of course, for this to happen, we also have a web server that is built in inside the Proxy SQL. So this is extremely useful. And related to this, we are also developing and will make available very soon also some Grafana dashboard, so people will be able to have to monitor the status of Proxy SQL using our recommended dashboards. And speaking about web server, another interesting features that I am very excited about it is the Enterprise Web UI. It is an enterprise features that we introduce in 2.1. So basically, we have created a web interface that allow to reconfigure Proxy SQL and visualize all the configuration of Proxy SQL and how it's behaving, what are the statistics, extract more statistics about the monitoring module, and so on. All this in a very easy to use web interface. So it will be extremely easy to configure and to have a feeling of what is happening inside Proxy SQL. So I would say those are the three main features that I am excited about.
Well, this is, I tell you, this is going to be a delightful release. I tell you why. The observability of Proxy SQL infrastructure, till in the recent past, was always a challenge, because how do I proactively troubleshoot Proxy SQL, right? With integration with Grafana, with your own, more visibility towards Proxy SQL operations metrics, I can be more efficient in troubleshooting the Proxy SQL infrastructure. Thanks, Rene, about it.
Hey.
Rene, how do you measure maybe a customer story who adopted Proxy SQL maybe earlier, maybe later, but then they used Proxy SQL to the best of their capabilities and how they benefited it? Do you want to discuss about that?
Yes. One of the most interesting story that comes to mind and is the deployment of Proxy SQL for its multiplexing ability. So that is the ability of using the same backend connection for multiple client connection. So this is a feature that is quite different from other proxy like HAProxy, because this is a pure TCP proxy. So instead of having a one-to-one mapping connection, like one client connection maps to one backend connection, Proxy SQL can have multiple client connections that are mapped to one single backend connection. And the reason why this is quite a An exciting feature for many of the users is that when they deploy PropertySQL, they see the database connection dropping from 20,000 to 80. Those are actually real number. And their first suspicion is something is not working, because it's quite difficult to understand that before you had 20,000 connections to database server, and now those connections are down to 80, and you have no performance penalty, but actually MySQL is processing those queries even faster. So huge number of connection dropped, and performance are getting way better. That's one of the features. Another example I can think of is PropertySQL being used for routing, for very complex routing. So basically, for sharding, basically a combination of sharding and routing. PropertySQL is able to perform sharding based on the username and the schema name. And we have quite large customers that has configured PropertySQL with more than 100,000 database server, database schema, sorry. And PropertySQL, based on the database schema, knows on which server it has to send the traffic. So it has a very fast table to perform the lookup. So based on the schema, it knows to which server it has to send traffic. So yes, quite impressive setup.
Wow. All right. Thanks a lot, Rene, for sharing about the best methods, practices to use PropertySQL, how to adopt, about new release features. We are excited. Thanks for being very active in making this community always you know, growth oriented, you know, like focused on sharing the knowledge what you gained over the period of time. That that actually fuels the entire open source community. Thanks for all your commitments and all your support towards the ecosystem. Personally, want to thank you for coming for Minerva DB Athena 2020 once again. Wishing you in advance a Merry Christmas, a great 2021, which let you travel more freely. All of us travel a lot, meet each other. Wishing you a safe year ahead, man.
Thank you. Thank you. It's my pleasure to be part of this community. And I mean, it's a community that I really loves. And likewise, I wish you a great Christmas and a happy new year for 2021. Hopefully, it will be a great year.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.